As a matter of fact, after lecture, they wanted you to speak in Urdu.
Yes.
Ask the question now, not to waste too much time.
Sorry, what is the purpose of our getting on to our
questions? You do the sermon.
I don't know, there are a number of questions that we want to ask. Is there a specific reason why we have gathered?
No, no specific reason as far as I know.
There can be no specific reason. There is no specific reason. The invitation has been open. We have set out.
Yeah, yeah.
People must come together and ask whatever they want to ask.
They
are easy to
ask.
Dr. Ansari. It is Seerat al-Nabi, Maulana Shibli Numani, has given the names of all the wives of the Holy Prophet. But he has omitted the name of Maria Kittiya. And we do know that Maria Kittiya had a son from the Holy Prophet by the name of Ibrahim. Now, was she or was she not the wife of the Holy Prophet?
She was the wife of the Holy Prophet.
Why did Maulana Shibli Numani omit her name from his list, from the list of the Prophet's wives?
I don't know. He is dead already, you see, and I can't ask him about it.
But is it not also true that Maulana Shibli Numani, Seerat al-Nabi, is one of the greatest histories on the life of the Holy Prophet?
Yes, it is so, but at the same time, it does not mean that because it's a comprehensive work. It is a comprehensive work only with regard to the different volumes that they have brought out in connection with the exposition of Islam. The book has become very bulky because of those expositions, not because of the fact that they have devoted the entire book to the life and personality and character of the Holy Prophet himself. It is a valuable book, there is no doubt about it. But there is much which has been left out, as a matter of fact. Because especially in the first volume, which was compiled by Maulana Shibli. Maulana Shibli was quite old in those days, and ultimately he passed away while he was doing this work. And I personally believe that he did not have the time to revise it properly and polish it up.
But you do accept that Maria Kittiya was the wife of the Holy Prophet?
Yes, she was.
Very significant that you should omit that. Yes. As many others have omitted.
Yes.
But there were four maid's slaves that he married, besides 11 wives.
No, I don't think
no,
so.
No, no, no.
Four, according to the book on Muhammad, there were 11 wives and four maid slaves.
Which one are you referring to?
It's just finished this morning on it. Regularly left from Islam. That's not true.
But it is
not. Is that 11 or 12?
11.
As a matter of fact, there has been created a sort of confusion in the medieval ages when the Muslims started writing, you see. In the first century of the Hijra, there was not much work of writing at all. The first century of the Hijra was taken up mostly by conquest and by consolidation of those conquests. The period of writing begins somewhere in the 2nd century and it blossoms actually in the 3rd century. And it's after that that you will find all these books that are available to you today about Islam. They date from the 3rd century, Hijra. By the time that the 3rd century arrived, different types of mischief were already there. The mischief which was challenged and about which Imam al-Bukhari did a very fine job, that was the mischief of forging a hadith. sayings which were attributed to the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and they were very, very large in number. And this, so to say, factory for manufacturing hadith was conducted and was run by the wisest men of the Jewish people. The function of the Jewish people has always been to discard any message that came from God. And unfortunately, they have played a very important part in creating mischief in various fields. We know it very well today that St. Paul was a Jew who had never met Jesus Christ. And he is regarded today as the premier saint of Christendom. Now, how this Jew came to be the exponent of Christianity or of the message of Jesus Christ? Modern researchers have told us that he was deputed for this purpose by the Jewish hierarchy, and he succeeded only too well. So the Jews started the same thing. They were intriguing against Islam from the very beginning. The steps which the Prophet ﷺ had to take against them in expelling them from the suburbs of Medina. They were expelled after their acts of violations of treaties and so on and so forth, and their nefarious activities. They were expelled from Khaybar and other Jewish places, you see, where they had settled down. So they could not bring any changes in the Qur'an, because the Qur'an had been given by the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam just as we have it now. The Qur'an had been memorized by numerous Sahaba during the lifetime of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Qur'an was in the form of a compendium, arranged in the same manner as we have it now. So it was not possible for them to make any changes in the Qur'an, as changes were made in Christian writings and in their own writings. But what they did was, they took up the second thing, that is the hadith, and they started forging a hadith. And the hadith which they forged, according to Imam Bukhari, they actually ran into more than 100,000. And the entire Muslim world was actually flooded with those hadith. And another thing had happened in those days, that vast multitudes of human beings had joined Islam. Their entry into the fold of Islam was not through missionaries so much as on their own part. Huge communities entered the fold of Islam, and when they entered the fold of Islam, they entered along with their priests. Among them were mostly Christians and the Magians, and even the Buddhists of Afghanistan, Central Asia, and so on. So they brought into the fold of Islam their old notions and all those things. And the Muslims who were there at that time, they tried their level best to brainwash them properly and to stabilize them in the proper teachings of Islam correct manner. But the task was too great, too immense, and the task could not be done properly. As a consequence, we find up to this day the Jewish folklore forming a part and parcel of Muslim thought. You will find the Jewish folklore mentioned in our commentaries of the Quran and our commentaries on the Hadith and so on and so forth. Up to this day, books that are being written by our ulama, by those ulama who have not been very cautious in connection with research and so on, those books in this 20th century and in this year of 1970 contain plenty of materials which are actually of Jewish origin. And they are not in keeping with what Islam says. So, in this state of affairs, when the work of writing had not yet been undertaken by the Muslims on any large scale, stories and ahadith and things of that sort were being forged and they were being concocted, and also different types of stories were coming along with the priests of the communities who entered the fold of Islam. So, actually, different wrong notions came to hold their sway in the Muslim community. And it is a fact that if you ask any of the ulamas here, your Mufti Sanjadvi or any other person, they will tell you that Islam upholds slavery, and Islam upholds concubinage, and they will swear by it, and they will say that anybody who says that Islam does not uphold concubinage is simply outside the fold of Islam. Wa alaykum as-salam wa rahmatullah. But as matters stand, the only book that can be regarded as 100% authentic is the Quran. So far as the sources of Islam are concerned, the only book that can be considered to be 100% authentic and correct is the Quran. The books of the Hadith, although they contain plenty of very valuable material, owing to the efforts of such great men as Imam al-Bukhari, they are not of the same value as the Holy Quran itself. Then again, if anything has been stated clearly in the Holy Quran, and there is anything which is to be found in any book of Hadith which contradicts it, then the law for all time is that the Quranic standpoint will be accepted and not that of the Hadith. Now, when you read the Quran, you find that the Quran has laid it down clearly that one of the missions of the Holy Prophet ﷺ was to abolish slavery. And he went to the extent that he made it the obligation of the Muslim state to set aside a part of its income, revenues, for launching a worldwide scheme whereby the institution of slavery could be abolished. That is clearly laid down in the Quran. And emancipation of slaves has been mentioned in the Quran as the highest social virtue. Highest. When the Quran says, وَمَا أَدْرَاكَ مَا الْعَقَبَةُ فَكُّ رَقَبَةُ, you see, when it says, what is the most difficult and the highest form of virtue, it says emancipation of slaves and abolition of this institution. As regards concubinage, the Quran is absolutely clear that any extramarital relation of whatever type it may be is totally prohibited in Islam. The only thing which Islam has sanctioned is marriage as a social contract between two free adult persons who must be sane in mind and who must undertake this obligation as a spiritual obligation primarily, with due consideration to all the implications. Beyond that, the Holy Quran has not mentioned any other type of thing. And so far as this institution of concubinage is concerned, it is totally ruled out by the Quran. And there cannot be the slightest opportunity for trying to interpret the Holy Quran in a manner whereby concubinage can be considered to have been sanctioned. But there are ahadith wherein you will find this. And there are stories concerning the life of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, for instance, in one of the earliest biographers of the Prophet, of course he was a Muslim. His name is Waqidi. Now, although Waqidi has been considered by our Muhaddithin as the one of the greatest liars who ever lived on the face of the earth, but Waqidi's book is quoted by, has been quoted by so many of our ulama themselves. I don't know how it could be actually possible. And this thing has provided a handle to the Orientalists and to the enemies of Islam for attacking the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Even in the Siha Sitta, the six authentic books of the Hadith, there are ahadith which cast a slur on the personality of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam and on Islam. And those people who do not possess a proper knowledge of things, our common run of the ulama and the masses, for them the siyasita is just as good as word of God. Anything said there in the six authentic books of the Hadith, you see, that is valid and that must be followed. This has created a very big mischief actually.
If you are considering that the human fallibility was there,
of course, let me finish it. That question. Excuse me. So consequently, Maria Qibtiya was married by the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And there was absolutely no question of any concubine in the household of the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam or in the household of any of the Sahaba, because that has been clearly and explicitly condemned outright in the Holy Quran. See? So, because Maulana Shibli could not rise to that level of research, therefore, it is also possible that he felt a bit uneasy about it and he did not mention it. It may be like that, isn't it?
But it gives a strong point to the enemies of Islam.
That it does. And that's what we have been doing. I mean, say that's what our ulama during the last 500 years, they have been doing. You know, if you know the problem, when I talk in such strong terms against the ulama of this age, it is not that I am not one of them. I am also a man primarily qualified in theology. But the thing is that the Muslims do not know through what courses and through what pathways Islam has been coming all these centuries. For instance, There is a sort of aqeedah, I might even call it aqeedah or belief, that certain verses of the Quran abrogate other verses. The aqeedah of nasikh and mansukh. Now in the beginning, such verses which were considered to be abrogated were more than 100. Then during the course of history, as scholars arose, as eminent scholars arose in the world of Islam, and they tackled this problem, the number of abrogated verses continued to become less and less. Until in the 19th century, in the beginning of the 19th century, I might say, Shah Waliullah, who is the last great Islamic classical theologian, last great Islamic theological scholar, he proved that there was not a single verse which was abrogated. Now just see on this point, we are fighting here whether we should read the Fatiha or we should not read the Fatiha, and this makes us Muslim or kafir. But such an important point was there, you see. I mean, say abrogation of certain verses of the Quran by other verses of the Quran, that is not a joke. It is something very far-reaching in its consequences in connection with our theology. Now, those people who considered that more than 100 verses of the Quran had been abrogated, were they Muslims or kafirs? And those who thought that there were only 80, and those who thought that there were only 50, and those who thought there were only 20, and he who thought there was none, what do you think about their Islam and about their kufr? You see?
Here, Maulana, we are simple people and we are rich and simple things.
Yes, that is right.
Mithras, in our simplicity, even Fatiha is important to some people and to some it is not.
No. I will say what I am saying is that this is a trivial issue actually
compared to that
issue.
We understand that point. But yes. Now, because of our lack of knowledge and because of our very, very minor knowledge with regard to Islam and what it stands for, these little things we hold fast to.
That's right. That's right.
And in that respect, we require and need and can in fact demand certain amount of guidance from learned people like this.
Sure, of course. No, but what I was saying about this particular question.
Further to that, little things do make difference to people too,
no? No, little things make difference to people.
Yes, of course. You see, now,
consequently, it is absolutely clear. I mean, say there are so many false notions among Muslims, for instance, about Ummul Mumineen Aisha. You see, there is a story which has come all through the centuries that she was 8 years old when she was married to the Holy Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. You see, although my research in that field has proved it conclusively that she was 18 years old and not 8 years old.
18.
Is it?
But that is not general consensus.
No. That's what I'm saying. No. What I'm saying is that just as in connection with the abrogation of verses in the Quran, it took 13 centuries for that problem to be ultimately clarified. When Shah Waliullah, who is accepted by Deobandis, Barelvis, and everyone else, you see, as the highest Imam of his age, when he proved, you see, that there is not a single verse which is abrogated. Now, in the same manner, about this question, about Hazrat Aisha, some scholars had to do it, and I was one of them, you see, and we came to this conclusion that it is absolutely false to say that she was 8 years old at that time.
But the marriage was actually consummated when she was 7. That is a general understanding.
No, that is wrong.
But Peter's Encyclopedia in Britain created a lot of fuss about it.
No. They will create fuss when Muslims themselves are giving the hint to them, you see. I mean, say, one great major contribution of Islam, one of the major contributions of Islam is the resolving of the dichotomy of faith and reason. In Islam, faith is not faith unless it is based on a rational understanding. The Quran is very clear on that. Because blind faith is no faith, according to the Quran. It is merely superstition. So, whatever the Quran has taught has got to be understood in the light of reason. And it has also got to be taught in the light of reason. And preaching has got to be done in the light of reason. It is not just that way. You see, during our 500 years, past 500 years, we have been teaching the people that when the Quran says that the Quran has come for those الَّذِينَ يُؤْمَنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ who believe in the unseen realities of life. Actually, what the Quran is saying, that the unseen metaphysical supra-sensuous reality of life, realities of life like heaven, hell and malaika and God himself. It has been translated to mean that who believe without seeing, who believe blindly, what will you do? And unless we had committed all these mistakes, this great ummah, which was meant to be the supreme ummah or the supreme ideological group in the world, and to stand supreme in every manner, as a social force, as an economic force, as a force in international affairs, as a spiritual force and as a moral force, and as an intellectual force. This ummah is now where?
Yes.
You see? So there must be some cause. And to attribute that cause only to our enemies were there from the very, very beginning, and we were a minority and they were a majority. Why couldn't they overpower us at that time? And why were they able to overpower us now? So actually we have not been true to Islam, although we have been true and genuine in our iman, whatever we knew.
But that is not enough.
That is not enough. That is not enough. I will say, if a child falls sick, and the child's mother, out of her conviction, indulges only in charms and magic and all that, and does not call in a doctor, and the child is not cured, then it is not any ill will on the part of the mother. It is not bad faith on her part. It is not ill will. It is really good will, but it is also bad reason.
Yes.
You see, and that is what we have been doing. I mean, say, so far as our love for Islam is concerned, that has been there. But so far as the understanding of Islam, and especially when the patterns of life have been changing continuously, especially since the Industrial Revolution. You see, it is a fact that technological change always brings a change in the pattern of culture. Change in the technological production pattern always brings a change in the pattern of culture. And the change in the pattern of culture always brings change psychologically, the psychological pattern of behavior. Now, when such tremendous changes had been taking place, Muslims were just saying, this is kufr, this is kufr, this is kufr, this is what the kafirs are doing, this is what the kafirs are doing, you see? And ultimately they were overtaken by the nemesis. So that, as I have been saying, when in the 19th century the Western powers attacked the world of Islam, from Morocco to Indonesia, the entire world of Islam collapsed like a house of cards, as if its foundations had already been eaten away. And they were eaten away. And what after that? What are we doing? I will say, our most pious people know nothing beyond ritualism. Nothing absolutely beyond ritualism. And consequently, Islam has become a cult. It is no more a comprehensive philosophy of life and the supreme way of life and this and that. Not at all. For nobody. And that thing cannot pay. And now we have gone to the extent of our idiosyncrasy in this matter. That is not merely ritualism as regards our obligations as they have been given to us. The five-time namaz and these things, you see, they are obligatory. But even those things which have not been made obligatory by anyone, either by God or by Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, that you should wear such type of dress. And the dress must be of a queer type in a Western environment also, in order that you may